programming, and we talk about program translation. Overall in the course, the material we talk about, as I say, we put quite a bit of emphasis on problem solving and algorithms. Programming is the core element of our program in UCD, and we deal with a number of different programming languages. Now, the language that I'm going to refer to in this introductory lecture is Python, and that's a language that we teach to some of our students, and we actually have introduced a new module for first-year students that introduces Python. But really, the emphasis on the programming courses, introductory programming courses in UCD, is that we try to teach you the basics. We try to teach you the theory, and then you can apply those basics, you can apply that theory to any programming language that you want to learn. Now, in order to understand properly how programming languages work and how programming works, we need to talk a little bit about the structure of a computer, which we do as well. When we're talking about a particular language, and here I talk about, as I say, I mentioned Python, but in first year, students cover C, the C programming language. You talk about syntax, which is what the language looks like, how it appears on paper or how it appears on the screen. Semantics, in other words, what the language actually means, what the instructions actually do. Then we have variables, statements. Statements are like basic instructions in the language. The flow of control, how we can actually tell the computer to do this statement and not do another statement, or how to do a particular statement a number of times. Input-output, how we actually communicate with the computer. Arrays, which are sort of how you collect or combine data into larger groups of data. And then subprograms, which are a technique for breaking up larger programs into smaller units. One of the important things when you're writing programs is to make sure that they're correct. And in order to make sure they're correct, you have to do extensive testing and what we call debugging of your programs. So we talk a bit about that. One of the most popular programming paradigms on the planet at the moment is object-oriented programming. Now, we don't actually introduce object-oriented programming in this module, but we will, towards the end of the module, we will give a lecture or two on object-oriented concepts, because you will be dealing with those quite a bit in later modules and in later years. And one of the features of any of our programming courses, and certainly any module that I'm involved with, is that there's lots and lots of examples to illustrate the various features that we talk about in the lecture. So, all of UCD's modules have got a module descriptor, and as part of the module descriptor, we list out the learning outcomes. In other words, what we expect students to know at the end of the module. So on successful completion of this module, students should be familiar with the important topics in computer programming, understand the fundamental elements of a programming language, be able to design algorithms, be able to write computer programs, and in this particular module, it was Python that we were looking at, be able to successfully run Python programs, be able to evaluate programs to find errors, and be aware of the basics of object-oriented programming. So that those are the things that we would expect students to know at the time, or by the time that the module is over. So what is programming? So programming involves a number of different steps. First of all, we have to identify the problem. So there is some problem that either we have, or if we work in a company, the company or our boss has, and we have to, either we help them identify it, or they identify the problem for us. Then we have to design a solution. Now, this design is unlikely to be done individually. It's likely nowadays to be done as part of a team or a group. There'll probably be some other systems that our solution will have to fit into, so we'll have to be mindful of that. And there may be other constraints in terms of costs and so on that if you're working for a commercial company, that you maybe have to be aware of as well. Then we express the solution as an algorithm. I'm going to be talking a bit more about algorithms in a few minutes, but that's the fundamental, map of the solution to the problem that we devise, is the algorithm. Then, and at this stage, we haven't actually touched programming as such at all. We certainly haven't touched the programming language. So the next step then is to actually translate the algorithm into a program in some specific programming language. Then the computer translates the program into machine code. And depending on the language that we use, there's a number of different techniques for that translation. We can either compile or interpret the language. So Python, for example, is an interpreted language. Java is an interpreted language. C, on the other hand, is a compiled language. But one way or another, it gets translated into machine code. And then we run the program, or in computer science parlance, we say we execute the program. Now, if we're very good at programming and very good at writing algorithms, then this program will work perfectly first time. The chances are that it won't. The chances are when we test the program, we'll find some errors or some bugs in it. And this idea of getting the bugs out of our program is what we call debugging. So we'll have to go back. We'll have to maybe check some errors we might have in our programming. We might have to check some errors we have in our algorithm. And in extreme cases, we may have to go back and look at a new solution, design a new solution to our problem. And then once we're satisfied that the program goes through all its tests successfully and all of the bugs are out of it, then we can put the program into service. So why do we bother programming a computer at all? Well, the big reason is that of speed. Computers can typically do operations much, much faster than humans can, particularly if it comes to arithmetic or other computational operations. They can also do those operations with much greater accuracy and precision than humans can. So if we're looking for accuracy or precision in our results, then the chances are we'll ask for a computer to do it. Another reason for getting a computer to do it is humans typically get bored if they're asked to do the same operation over and over again. So if, for example, there's lots of additions to be done of maybe all of the purchases that were made in a shop during the day, and we have to want to get the total, and we have to add up all of the numbers, and we have to do that every hour, every day, for every week, then a human will easily get bored doing that. So one of the things about computers is that they don't get bored. So we can give them the same operations to do over and over again, and they'll do that unless something extraordinary happens, they'll do it without mistake every time. Another reason that we'll get a computer to do stuff for us is because what we want them to do is maybe a bit dangerous. Okay, so if we want to defuse a bomb, or if we want to go to an uncharted planet, then we'll typically send some sort of robot there first, just because there's a lot of danger involved. We don't want to risk human life. And there's also some things that computers are better at than humans, and in particular, as I mentioned before, arithmetic or other computations. Computers are typically better at those. They do it faster, they do it more accurately and with more precision than humans can. So what do we do when we actually program? So a computer program, as I say, is written to solve a particular problem. Now, in general, it's the programmer who solves the problem, not the computer. All the computer does is take the program and execute it or run it, but it's the programmer who actually has written the design, the algorithm, and translated that into a programming language. Now, I would say that there has been some research done recently on computers actually writing programs. And that's a current research topic. But in general, for most commercial programs, it's the programmer who solves the problem, not the computer. And what the programmer does is gives the computer precise instructions on what to do. And that's what we call the program. So the program then is a description to the computer of what it has to do and how to do it. The program is a solution to the problem. When it's executed, we'll get the required results. And the set of steps required to solve a problem is called the algorithm. And an algorithm written in a particular programming language is called a computer program. So we start off with our problem. We get a design a solution to that. We formulate that solution as an algorithm. And then we translate the algorithm into a particular program in a programming language. And that's what the computer runs. And that's essentially the task of programming. So, you might ask, well, why do we need a programming language? What's wrong with natural languages? We use natural languages all the time, and we can usually make ourselves understood, whatever about the accent, but usually we can get the concepts across. So what's wrong with natural languages? So natural language, as I say, there is expressive, flexible, and rich, but It's also ambiguous and it's imprecise. There are also many natural languages, but we would prefer to have one precise language that everybody could use to share the concepts that we have in programming. So here's some examples of the ambiguity that we have in natural languages. You should have seen the bull we got from the Pope, okay? So this has got at least three different readings. And that's assuming that we've only got one Pope, because in the Middle Ages there would have been a situation when we would have had two or even three different Popes at the same time. One reading of this first statement is that a bull is a letter from the Pope to his flock. So you should have seen the bull we got from the Pope could mean, well, the Pope has written us all a letter and you should have seen what he said, you should have seen it. Another use of the word bull is that rubbish. So you might not agree with what the Pope said in his letter. You should have seen the bull we got from the Pope in that letter we got last week. Okay, so that's a second reading. Another reading of it is that the Pope is actually the head of state. He's the head of state of the Vatican, and maybe he was on a state visit to some poor country in Africa, for example, and as a gesture of goodwill and support, he brought them a male cow, a bull, and he gave them the bull as a present. You should have seen the bull we got from the Pope. So as you can see, even though it's all the words in that sentence we know, there's a fair bit of ambiguity. Just quickly looking at the second one, competent women and men hold all the good jobs in the firm. So first of all, there's a bit of ambiguity there. Is what constitutes a good job? Is it the manager's job? Or is it somebody who can come into work, sneak into work every day and get paid for doing nothing? Or is it a job that allows you to have good promotion prospects? And then at the very beginning of that sentence, competent women and men. So is it competent women and competent men? Or is it competent women and men, no matter how useless they might be, hold all the good jobs in the firm? So there's a lot of ambiguity in natural language. We also have a lot of imprecision in natural language. So Albert is tall. So this all depends on what we mean by tall and who Albert is. So if Albert is sort of somebody living in Ireland, an adult living in Ireland, and they're over, 1.80 meters or so, then they'd be regarded as tall. If they're in baby infants and they're 1 meter tall, they'd be regarded as tall. But if they, even if they're 1.80 meters and they're playing on a US college basketball team, they wouldn't be regarded as tall. So the measure of tall, or the meaning of tall there, is very imprecise. It all depends on the context. The tall that we have for Albert is completely different from the tall that we might have for the Albert Hall, which is a concert hall in London, which is a few hundred meters tall. And that is nothing compared to the tallness of the Burj Khalifa in Dubai, which is almost a kilometer tall. Okay, so this whole notion of tall is very imprecise and can lead to a lot of confusion if we use it in conversation. Similarly, the ferry is huge. That all depends whether it's a ferry from Burtonport to Aranmore in Donegal, or from Baltimore to Sherkin or Clear in Cork, or whether it's the ferry that goes from Dublin to France or from Cork to France. The computer is fast. A computer that's fast nowadays, a computer that's fast 20 years ago wouldn't be fast nowadays, or wouldn't be considered fast nowadays. And the 100 meters was fast depends on whether this 100 meters is been run on the Olympics, or it's 100 meters been run by Albert from baby infants. So what is an algorithm? An algorithm is a set of instructions that when executed will solve a particular problem. Typically, it involves a finite set of instructions, so there's a limited number of instructions, and also it runs in finite time. That is, it stops eventually. Now, there are some situations where we don't want the algorithm to stop. So, for example, if our algorithm is monitoring the nuclear power plant down the road, then we want that to run all the time. Similarly, if our algorithm is controlling the Airbus that we're flying in, then we want that to keep going all the time, or at least until some point that the pilot turns off the ignition or whatever they do to stop an airplane. Algorithm, the word algorithm originally comes from the name of a Persian mathematician in the 9th century who wrote on the calculation of Hindu numerals. And when this was translated into Latin, then the word algorithmi was what came out of his surname, Al-Khwarizmi. I'm just going to finish off then by looking at a sort of an analog, a real world analog of an algorithm. Now, everybody since lockdown has been doing lots of cooking and baking. Certainly, it's been happening in our house. And this possibly isn't one of the recipes that you've been doing because it's not the season for tea brack, even though I think personally that tea brack should be in season all year round. But so this is actually a real life recipe. It comes from Odlums, the Odlums website. So you need self-raisin flour, fruit mix, cold tea, caster sugar, an egg and mixed spice and so on. So you've got the ingredients, which are your basic variables, if you like, for your program. And then you've got your method, which is your algorithm. So this is a reasonable analog of an algorithm. But however, there are a few problems because it's not really an algorithm. So there's a bit imprecise. There's lots of detail left out. For example, if you were to give this to a computer or a robot to do, how do you beat an egg? It doesn't say how to beat an egg. Also, what kind of tea do you use? So anybody who makes tea brack knows that you have to use Barry's or Lion's or something like that. You don't use chamomile or something like that. That's not going to give you the same flavor on your tea brack. What's a good pinch? Now, most bakers and cooks will know what a good pinch is. It's certainly not a fistful. Which shelf in the oven? Because bakers and cooks will know that the shelf that you put your stuff on in the oven is going to make a difference to the heat. What is overnight? So, for example, if you are a night owl and you don't go to bed until 3 o'clock in the morning and you get up at 7 o'clock, is that enough of an overnight compared to somebody who goes to bed at 10 o'clock and doesn't get up till midday? Also, the recipe says approximately 1 hour. It makes reference to the word risen, and it makes reference to, it talks about being firm to the touch. Again, there's a lot of imprecision there. Also, there's a bit of ambiguity in the algorithm. So it talks about add sugar, egg, flour, and mixed spice, but it doesn't say add to what. Remember, we're talking, if we want to have this as an algorithm, think of trying to explain this to a stupid robot, okay? So everything has to be explained in detail. And also, the recipe doesn't account for fan-assisted ovens, because as you know, or as bakers will know, a fan-assisted oven will be hotter. You'll either put it in for less time or you'll need less heat. And one of the omissions that we have in our algorithm is that it doesn't actually say to take it out of the oven. If you actually read the recipe carefully, it forgets to say take the thing out of the oven. So this is the first quarter hour of an introductory lecture to programming. We go on to talk a bit about algorithms. We talk a bit about algorithm design. And it's actually, certainly in any module I would give, it's probably lecture two before we actually start talking about particular programming languages and before we start talking about how to actually encode our algorithm in the programming statements we have available in the language. You might think that this is a bit introductory and I might be preempting one of the questions that Gary will have, but it is just to emphasize the fact that in the computer science program in UCD, we don't expect any prior experience of programming. So we start off from scratch and we don't assume that you have seen programming before.